Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Kate, and everybody who has who's here for coming and for making my day so far really great. A lot goes into this community. I am going to show you a video. I'm going to show you a video, and then we can start. This video is 3 minutes and 51 seconds.
I'd like to ask you a favor, which is to
little bit so that, because I want to try something tonight, especially with people in the back, you know, just kind of move and fill up so I'm not sort of tossing to the last row. To hear, you know, six people read their work that just involved words, and I think that because it was a lot of it was prose poetry, so that the it wasn't so abstract, and the writers were so strong in crafting the emotion. And I thought a lot about it later in terms of how different it was from painting, because it seemed to me, I don't know if it was curated this way, but it seemed to me that the writers had a lot of things in common. And one of the things they had in common was that they could talk about loss and endurance, the pain of endurance, pain of loss, and also creating both mental spaces and actual spaces simultaneously. So that that kind of left me with an impression, and I thought about how it contrasts with visual arts, and I'll talk about painting since I'm a painter, and how terribly physical painting is, and so that it's a kind of another object in the world, and whereas writing is words, and words, you know, there are philosophers who say that we don't actually have thought until we have words, so that when we give, as a painter, when I give the world an object, people look at it and they have a sort of a feeling tone in response. And people don't always trust feeling tone. They need words to make, to create a support system for visual arts. And that's why so many writers become art critics and end up getting jobs writing press releases. And so what I thought I would do is do this lecture a little bit differently than standing here and telling you the background of everything, because I don't really want to tell anybody how to think or feel about my work. But I don't want you to leave thinking like, well, what the hell is she doing, you know? So I'm going to kind of do a little mix. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to fairly quickly go through my old work that, and you will get a gestalt feeling for what I've been up to. Then I will show you, I will go a little slower with more recent work, and the project I did, Museum of Contemporary Art in Taipei, needs explanation. It's a world religions project, which you saw the video of. Part of it. So that I will give you an explanation, and then we'll go into my last works. And what I would like is I would like a discussion about the work as we get towards later on, or if you have a question to ask, but as we get towards the end of the work, and that you participate in what you want to know about the work, what, you know, testing your thoughts and feelings to see if they kind of correlate with what I'm trying to do. I think that there are so many visual arts talks that it's just like blah, blah, blah. And after last night, was, you know, so many beautifully crafted words, I sort of thought, enough of words. studies I did for the charting Secret Territories exhibition in Taipei, the museum asked me to submit a proposal of what I wanted to do, and I thought that it would be very interesting to do a show on world religions, because I've always looked at the earliest art has been religious art, and some of the richest art is religious. So I thought I'd look at all the varying components of religious art. So I took the six major religions: Judaism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, Taoism, and plus the natural religions, shamanism, in the seventh category. And I would look at architecture, and I would look at arabesque, and I would look at ritual vessels. And I'm sorry the last row is cut off. But to look at, to sort of study what that was in each religion. And at the same time, I was also really interested in, I'll tell you that in a minute. But here is what the architectural floor plans looked like when they were layered on top of each other. So for Christianity, I learned, for example, that it's largely in the shape of a cross. In Islam, it centers around a dome. In Hinduism, Buddhism, and Taoism, it's kind of a temple compound where there's a wall, and then there are many separate buildings inside. And Judaism, because it's a largely nomadic religion, takes on the vernacular architecture of the location where they are. So these are the ritual vessels for Hinduism, Buddhism, and Taoism. And they're all incense burners. But the ritual vessels in the Western religions tended to be vessels that held liquid for either washing or drinking purposes. And the arabesque overlap a lot, and it makes a lot of sense because they're in cultural proximity to each other. So they share, the Western religions share a lot more with each other than they do with the Eastern religions for that reason. And then you'll recognize these are the images that were in the video, but in this group of studies, what I was looking at was how the center, the mandala format, played out in various religions. So I started working with the center in about 1998, when I went through a big change in my life, and the center became a kind of way to work to rebuild your center. You know, it's kind of perfect metaphor for the mandala. And then as I was constructing a circle format, I started looking at all the mandalas from Eastern religions. And then I thought, well, I wonder how other religions take into account the circle. So I went and I looked at books of ceramics, of paintings, of decorative coverings for the Torah, the Bible. I looked at manuals, like Taoist manuals. I looked at a Buddhist medicinal manual. And I even looked at Hindu temple ceilings, and I went into, I did a virtual trip to a Hindu temple, and I spent about half an hour walking through this temple, looking at everything. You can take your little cursor, and you can, you know, jump 6 feet, and you can look up, and you can look to the side, and look to the side. I went every inch of this temple. And I didn't see anything, and on my way out, I saw two images on the ceiling, which at least two images were here. And they were just perfect because they were so enigmatic, especially this one. So this is Islam, this is Judaism, and if you cover the top part of this painting, you can see that it's a menorah. This is from a ketubah. This is from a ketubah. And this is from a Torah covering. This is from the 7 days of a Jewish calendar. Here you can see the cross. This is from a monstrance. So this is a Coptic cross. This is an image of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Buddhism, this is the aureole behind the Buddha. The vapor that comes out of a Tibetan Buddhism concoction to heal. This is a Buddha would sit in front of this. Of course, this is also to some extent my interpretation. You know, for example, the menorah double is something that I'm doing. This image here is sort of maps out a pilgrimage, a Buddhist pilgrimage. This is the drapery of a Buddha, two Buddhas actually doubled. And then this is Taoism. These are talismans that come from a kind of rituals. It's a way to petition the heavens to give you something that you want. And then this is from Jain religion. So. This painting is 18 foot long, and so the studies became two 18 foot paintings. And so this is the Western religions. And this is the Eastern. Hinduism, Buddhism, Taoism. And for Taoism, the one on the right, it's the halo of one of the lords of Taoism, and then the 26 planets. And inside is a little notation for the dance, the purification dance. Then I also wanted to. I decided to take on this crazy idea to map out the sects, denominations, and groups of all of the religions. So this is the natural religions in the West. This is Judaism. And this is Abraham. So the Abrahamic religion, this goes into Christianity. And then later, it goes into Islam. And I'll show you close-ups of all these branches. So here you can see the part of Christianity. And this is Roman Catholic, and I tried to give Roman Catholic a bigger presence because they're so, statistically, they're quite a large group. So I included mendicant orders and branched it out a little bit more. Here are the early Eastern Orthodox groups. and there's groups that are also denominations that are also now extinct. So this is very heavily researched. It's actually maddening. this is Islam. So we have the, you know, the Sunnis and the Shias. And I was running up to Columbia and Barnard begging professors to work with me. And they generously gave me, you know, about 1 hour each just to sort of look at the map. You know, at first they were like, nah, you can't do this, nobody can do this, I'll see you later. And then I would just like talk to them, and then they, you know, then I said, does this look like it's kind of in the right place? And, you know, and they made some suggestions, and they were very helpful. And in the end, the nun who said, no, it can't be done, it's absolutely not, but she was a scholar. She's a PhD in early religions, including mostly Judaism and Christianity. So she really helped me with those two. Okay, so that the circle is all of the contemporary Sufi groups in the world. And I never knew that there were so many Sufi groups around the world. Judaism. So the writing at the very top, this is all the Hasidic groups from Eastern Europe, many who have moved to the U.S., different parts of the world. And then here these are the groups that are like the Santeria groups in Haiti and the, you know, the Caribbean. These are the African groups of shamanism. Then this is Mexico. This is Native American. And then these groups are all along the Eskimos and the northern, more northern shamanistic groups. So this is the Eastern religions, and we have Sikhism, Hinduism, Jain, Vedic, which is the birth of Hinduism, Buddhism, Bon, the first religion in Tibet. This is Taoism, Shintoism. I threw Confucianism in there because it's a little bit, most people consider Confucianism not a religion, but if you go into China and some of the temples, you see Confucius, Buddha, and also the three of them statues, and they're all given equal importance. These are the shamanistic groups in Asia. So these are all the ethnic minorities in China, which there are over 80. These are the Taiwanese shamanistic groups, the ones in the Philippines, ones in India, Sepik River, Indonesia, Carolinas, and a lot of those islands. And in Hinduism, what's unique about Hinduism is that they have all these little wiggly lines. And the wiggly lines represent the ascetic groups. So that all the branches of, most of the branches of Hinduism have ascetic groups in some area. And then here, these are all of the goddesses. And the funny thing is that there's Vishnava and Shiva, and Vishnu and Shiva. And I had to consult two professors at Columbia because they were so versed in the specificity of each religion, each branch, that they didn't know enough to advise me on the other. Okay, this is Buddhism, beginning with Theravada and branching out into Mahayana, going up into Tantric. This is all of the branches in Tibet. And then when it goes into Pure Land and Zen, Chan becomes Zen. It goes into Vietnam, Korea, and then some of the contemporary groups here. And then these are all the groups in Southeast Asia. And in Taoism, this is sort of interesting right here, which is unique and is not on any of the other sections of the map. So here, it branches out into a separate group, which later becomes back into the main group. And then here, it branches into two groups, which later disappear and comes back into the main group. So we have that little unusual part. Okay, this is the close-up of all the Chinese shamanistic groups. And so that was the World Religions Project, and I recently showed it in Hong Kong. And then these are paintings I did before and after the World Religions Project. And so what started out as the as a decade of working with the center structure became the world. And it wasn't until after I started working with the world, I realized it was because I was traveling a lot to China. So I had this point of view, being on an airplane for 14 hours, of the world that sort of altered my perspective. I started to zoom back a little bit more. And I also thought it was very appropriate that after a decade of working with the center, it's kind of like, all right, well, I think I've become centered, and or at least functionally centered, and now it's time to open up and look at larger structures. These are different depictions of the world. This is the relationship of various cities in the Eastern Hemisphere. This is looking at the world from the point of view of the Arctic. So the center is the North Pole. And it's of interest because of the number of countries that are contesting the territory for oil consumption, oil dominance. This is a depiction of the wind currents in the world, with the world as it opens up and flattens out. And then this is both hemispheres. This is the Western and this is the Eastern Hemisphere. And this is kind of looking at trees and energy and world and yin yang at the same time. And then this is, these are, it's a little difficult to describe, but they have to do with a series of Qigong meditations that are both at the same time dealing with the energy in the core, and at the same time you're also able to send your spirit, your imagination into the universe. It's a little bit esoteric, but I learned these meditations, and it's very trippy. This also has to do with conceiving of healing internal organs. And at the same time, thinking about the world and the world and its relation in the universe. This is a group of paintings that I did that, I work very intuitively, I see visions. I think everybody sees visions, but some of us pay attention to the visions and make something out of it. And I started learning how to do that, just to slow down and not to dismiss my momentary flashings. And then I also was thinking so much about imagining the larger cosmos that I created kind of entities that were presences that were cogent about life on this planet. These paintings were done in a residency in China. I was in China at this residency for 3 months, and I made 11 large paintings, which was the hardest I've ever worked, but it was, aside from the Chinese Sacred Territories project, which was the hardest I ever worked. But it was really, really an ecstatic time for me. I had gone to a museum in Germany, the Pergamon Museum, and took pictures of small statues that I just kind of gravitated towards. And then I did ink paintings of them in China, and I had never done ink paintings before. So that was very new for me. And then I don't really work figuratively, but I thought I would try to see what would happen if I put this figure in. And I thought of these figures as sort of spirit guides. And this is a figure, an Egyptian figure. This was a little bit of a painting in preparation for going to Tibet, thinking about going to the highest mountain in the world and, you know, this great plateau. So this is a kind of a depiction of the mountains of the world, the highest mountains in the whole world. And of course, you know, this would be Mount Everest. The two images here. So these two images. Okay, so this is a wolf which is known as a sacred spirit in the Ordos, and this is the Guanyin. And I took the outline of each figure and created with lines going in and lines going out. So this is from this ear here, okay? And then you can kind of see how it just goes around. And then it's a kind of hallucination of sort of energy lines. And this painting is called The Dream. I had a dream that I walked into a gallery, a specific gallery in Europe, and it was my solo exhibition. And I looked at one of the paintings, my paintings on the wall, and I thought the whole show was, I was so breathless because it was so beautiful. And it's like, wouldn't I love to have this dream every night? And I looked at one particular painting, and it was all these brushstrokes that showed land in a kind of a very strange formation with all this light coming through. So, and I instantly woke up, and I was like, wow, that was so amazing. So I went back to sleep, and I looked at the painting a little more carefully, and then I got up and went to my studio and began this painting. So the group that I did in China were a lot about, you know, trying to move out of the center and going up out of the body.